like to thank Emerson PTA, Emerson Junior High School PTA, the DaVinci Boosters, and Patwin PTA for making this happen. And we're also being sponsored this evening by Davis Media Access, who's recording this for future viewing. The session tonight, we have four candidates. We have Susan Lovenburg, we have Alan Fernandes, we have Bob Poppenga, and we have Dr. Jose Granda. And the way that it's gonna work this evening is each candidate will have 5 minutes to speak freely about whatever they'd like, and then we'll move into some fixed Q&A, and then I'm hoping some of you will ask some questions via the index cards that are available with pens right as you come in. The candidates will see a yellow sign at 30 seconds left and a red when it's time to kindly stop and move on to the next candidate. So at this point, what I'd like to do is start our time for 5 minutes with Dr. Granda.
Good evening. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm Jose Granda, and I have the theme of my candidacy, the three T's, teaching, technology, taxpayers. So I decided to introduce myself with technology. So here's a PowerPoint presentation that conveys directly that message. And I consider myself a different candidate in many ways because I have different positions on issues, but I would like you to get to know me. 34 years of teaching experience in STEM, in technology, education, and engineering and math. This STEM, for those of you not familiar, stands for science, technology, engineering, and math. I have taken the position for the AIM program to be open to everybody, to keep the program with high standards, but the admission is where I would like to see that they would be more open to with the consultation with parents and teachers. I would like to implement technology in the classroom in many ways, and I think we'll be discussing some more later on. I gave languages the highest priority. I was born in South America, so my mother language is Spanish. And I learned German. I lived in Germany and lived in Switzerland. And I also live in France. So I speak Spanish, German, and French. And I know, because of my experience with other educational systems in those countries, how important that is for the education. I believe in cultural diversity and sensitivity, because I understand particularly the Hispanic culture, and living in Germany, I also understood many other cultures that come from the Middle East and other countries. I will be an advocate for fiscal responsibility and responsibility to the taxpayers. And I would like to become an advocate also for the unrepresented and the disabled students. I have personal experiences in both of those areas in my own family, and I believe that I can represent those interests well. This is just to give you some idea of what my life has been these 34 years, and this is my life in the classroom. From any teacher that invites me, this is what I do. With them, I go and do projects with kids, from little kids all the way to university kids. But I can see several teachers that have invited me. I have been there. And these are the projects that we built there with my wife's help, also as an assistant. She used to work for the education department at NASA, where I spent almost the last 10 years as an adjunct professor. And we do projects in the schools, and you see some of those in there. And the last picture that you see in there are my students and I on the day that the space shuttle flew for the last time over Sacramento. And that was the closing for me also of 17 space shuttle missions in which I participated in, particularly communicating to the community, in simple words, what the engineers were doing. This is my family, from the left side, my daughter Christina, who studied at this school. Sarah too, they studied at this school. And JJ is my youngest guy. He's at the University of Arizona now. And David, who also studied here at Emerson. This beautiful lady here in the middle is my wife, Imelda, who's sitting here. And this is my hobby. I have been, if I'm not doing engineering or doing other things, other projects, on Saturdays you will see me in the field. I am the senior referee for AYSO here, 35 years with your kids. So chances are that we might have seen each other in one of the fields. Positions. I have taken the position of yes on Measure 30 to fund the schools, yes on Proposition 51 to fund the school facilities, yes on Proposition 55 to improve school funding, yes on grants for schools, no Measure H. And I also want to take a position on Proposition 64 to protect your kids from drugs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Granda. Bob?
Good evening. Thank you, Mary, for organizing this. It's a fantastic opportunity to reach out to the community. If only I'd known, I could have had a PowerPoint presentation, being from the university. We're dependent on PowerPoints often. So I want to thank, first of all the great people who are working on my campaign. I think it's been a tremendous effort, and I couldn't do it without them. It's great to get out in the neighborhoods, walk from house to house, and listen to people in the community talk about our schools. It's amazing the diversity of issues that they do engage me about. And I'm always excited to learn new ideas that possibly we haven't thought of before. My family, we have been in Davis for 12 years. My wife and I are faculty at the School of Veterinary Medicine at UC Davis. I have two children, a 9-year-old who is at Holmes Junior High and an 11th grader at the high school. Very different children. The youngest one has been in the AIM program. The oldest one came to my family as an English language learner at age 10. And so we've seen how the public education system can deal with the very diverse needs within a family. As many people know, I ran for school board in 2014. I bring that up because I think I have a pretty good record in terms of expressing my opinions in the Davis Enterprise, in the Davis Vanguard, letters to the editor, across a whole diversity of issues, whether it's related to maintaining world languages programs in our district to housing affordability for teachers. And I'm very proud of the fact that in 2014, I think I was the only candidate that brought up the issue of affordability of housing in Davis for teachers. As far as my background, I am a product of public education. Coming from the Midwest, University of Illinois is where I got my DVM and PhD degrees. I have been at a university for almost 29 years. And I think that experience in a classroom, because I've taught over the course of those 29 years, I think that experience is very valuable because I understand what it's like to be in a classroom, all of the hard work that teachers put in behind the scenes to make it look easy in the classroom. I've been involved in a number of university committees that have looked at evaluating teaching and looking at curricular issues. So I think that's a very valuable perspective that can be applied to Davis schools. With regard to community involvement, I'm on the board of Explore Science Center, which is a marvelous resource in our community that focuses on hands-on inquiry-based training and education at the elementary school level. And I think that's an example of where the school district could partner very productively with a local institution. I have been involved with Jesse Ortiz, who's the county superintendent of education, in his effort to increase opportunity for quality preschool throughout the county. And I think that's an ongoing issue that hopefully at some point will come back to the ballot and the voters for approval. I've been in the Sunrise Rotary Club, focused on some of the youth activities of that particular club. We sponsor the Student of the Month, which brings in high school students and recognizes them for their achievements in school. I'm involved in providing scholarships to high school seniors. In fact, It's been a real highlight the last 2 years because I've gotten to give the Rotary Sunrise Scholarship to graduates of our adult high school and then King High School. And these are smaller graduation ceremonies, and it's just a real pleasure to see the excitement on those students' faces as they transition into career pathways. So I believe my science background is an important attribute for the board. I think that diversity of experiences, diversity of backgrounds is an important thing, particularly when STEM subjects are of increasing interest. And I also believe that science background can help look at data, judge programs based upon expected outcomes, and how do we assure that we're doing a good job and spending money wisely. I'll end by saying that just this morning I had a group of veterinary students. We did a little problem-based learning exercise, and at the end of the exercise they each go around and they say, what went well with that session? And they all point out what they felt like they did well. And then the next step of that is, even better yet, what could we do better the next time we get together? And so that's sort of my attitude with our schools. We have great foundation, but what can we do better?
Thank you very much, Bob. Let's go ahead and move to Alan.
Great. Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight, and thank you for the PTAs who organized tonight. My name is Alan Fernandes. I'm currently on the Board of Education here in Davis, and I'll get to how I got on the board a little later, because I do think it's relevant to some of the work that I've done, both on the board and what I want to focus on. But I guess I'll start from the beginning as well, at least my beginning here in Davis. I came to UC Davis in 93, so about 23 years ago, through a path that's very common to many of us, which is as a student at UCD. And I think that's relevant because I really got a real flavor for living the campus life and understanding what it's like to be a student on the university in this larger community. Had no idea what a wonderful place it is to grow and raise children and a family. I met my wife, who grew up here, DPNS all the way through UC Davis. And in both of us, we found a love of public service. And we find no other higher calling than really committing ourselves to a cause or the public good. And that's really, if I would sum up my experience and my background, I would say that it really is a passion for public service and serving the community. And here in Davis, I believe there's no greater way to do that than through our school system. I graduated from UC Davis, got a job in the finance industry, quickly realized I didn't really care for crunching numbers all day per se, and then pursued law, graduated from law school, became a lawyer, still focusing on public service. Practiced law for a bit before I ultimately settled into a career in and around government affairs, which I think is also a noteworthy experience, given the fact that a school district is so dependent on everything that occurs in Sacramento, given not only our funding stream coming from the state, 80% of it, but all of the laws and regulations, and really much of what happens in Sacramento directly impacts the way we have to run our school district in many ways. But understanding that, I think, gives you a keen insight, too, into how to be creative and what will work and what won't work. Throughout my career, I also really made a point to involve myself in the community. I was a Yolo County CASA, which is a court-appointed special advocate, and I've been focused around children and in the intersection of children and into not only our school system, but many other public and social services that we have as a community. I got involved with the Business and Economic Development Commission, was part of the group that got the U.S. Bicycling Hall of Fame. So I have a deep understanding of the unique, diverse strengths of our community. And I really feel that I'm able to really employ those strengths here in my service on the school board. Well, in around 2012, I decided, you know what? I looked at the school board and I said, I feel like there's a lot of focus that's needed around elementary. There was this, dynamic where many of the board members were parents of older children when, in fact, you know, half or more of our population is elementary age. And I felt like there needed to be a focus there. And I ran really because I thought parents of young children should be involved. And I know why parents of young children aren't, because we're very, very busy. But I'm fortunate enough to have a wealth of family support to be able to do this. And so I ran unsuccessfully, but was, as it turned out, later appointed. I was appointed when a vacancy occurred, and it was really at an interesting time for our district where really the trust of the district and our board was at stake. And I've committed myself to restoring that trust and accountability. I was appointed and shortly after elected president by my colleagues. And last year, I'm happy to say, I think we've done more to increase transparency and accountability with our school district than ever before. Establishing board office hours, I was just at it right before here. Assigning responsibilities to each school site. But I decided to run after 2.5 years being on the board because there's a lot more to do. And candidly, I want to focus on engaging all of our students and supporting our struggling students. 50% of our African American and Latino children are below standards. And I think that as a community that espouses our beliefs, we need to really meet that problem head on. I want to engage our teachers and make them more make the district more competitive to attract and retain. And I want to really enhance our school facilities. And that's what I'm committed to focusing on should I be reelected.
Thank you very much, Alan. We're going to end the 5 minutes with Susan, and then after this, we're going to move into three Q&A predefined questions, in which we'll be starting with Bob and coming this way with the answers.
Thank you. So 5 minutes is a little more generous than we're usually given, and I'm inspired by my colleagues up here to actually, I think almost everybody in this audience knows me, and so I'm inspired to actually give you a little bit more of my life story than I usually do, because it's interesting. It really does help, I think, understand why we're motivated to do the things that we do. So I was born in Bermuda in 1958. My father was in the Air Force, and so for the next 16 years, we moved really all over the United States, living in many different states, and it was a long time to be 2 years in one location. When I was in high school, we settled in upstate New York, up near Watertown, so very far northern New York, and that's where I did my university degree. I got a Bachelor of Science in Natural Resources from Cornell University. Then worked for a while. I actually worked in the rare book department at Cornell University. Decided that I wanted to do a Master of Library Science, but took a side trip for a couple of years to Holland, where we lived while my husband did a postdoc following his PhD, which he received at Cornell University. Then we came back. I did my Master of Library Science at Syracuse University, back again where my family was. And at that point, my husband was a Canadian. We moved to Canada. So lived in first Edmonton at the height of the Edmonton Oilers and their Stanley Cup wins. And then moved to Fredericton, New Brunswick, which is actually east of Maine, if you look on the map. And lived there for 8 years, where our first two daughters were born. Moved to Davis in 1997, when my husband was recruited to the Faculty of Animal Science here at the university. And at that point, I was began my second career. So I'd been a professional librarian in a number of university libraries and special libraries. Decided to stay home with the kids. So I spent 10 years with staying at home with my children. I had a third daughter who was born in 1998. And through that time, really got very involved as a volunteer in the school system. So, you know, it's the way you start saying, I'll do this, and you end up doing that and that and that. And so my children went through Willett here at Emerson and then at Davis High. I was active on all of those PTAs, doing mostly things like school listservs and newsletters and websites. And then when I was at the high school, I was a parent education coordinator for a couple of years. And then really got engaged at the school district level and began following school politics. And at a time in 2007, when two seats were opening up on the board, and there were not actually that many candidates who were interested in filling those seats. So I got recruited to run and did, and have served on the school board since 2007. As soon as I was elected, the economic recession started to tank. which caused just a round of budget reductions, state cuts. I think you all probably remember that time. So in addition to what we were doing within the school district, so that's the time that we started working on district dollars to help the community understand where the district's money was being spent and to give them an opportunity to weigh in on what the priorities of the district should be. We also started to organize, so the Davis Schools Foundation actually ramped up at that point, and there were two very successful, more than $1 million fundraising campaigns. We also, a group of us, started to advocate for education funding at the state level, and out of that created or co-founded a group called Saving California Communities, which continues today. In fact, we have a forum next Monday on civility in the public space. Isn't that the right topic for the right time? So that group still continues to meet and host public forums on topics of community interest. Also a spinoff from that was my work. I am a co-founder of the Yolo County chapter of the Brady Campaign to Prevent Gun Violence. So that's a group that's been active for about 3 years, advocating for the prevention of gun violence. And then at the time that I was ready, thank you, to go back to work, had gotten involved with California Forward, which is a good government group, and so that was my third career. I now work full-time for California Forward at the same time that I have served on the school board since 2007. So that was my life story in 5 minutes.
Thank you. The reason we wanted to provide 5 minutes is a lot of the forums very quick. We also don't have rebuttal periods during this particular format of the forum, so it's always great to get a chance to know you a little bit as candidates. So thank you for that first portion of the discussion. The second part that we're going to move to, that we will start with Bob in just a moment and work down this way, are three prescribed questions that the candidates are now aware of what they are. I'd also encourage you to, because after that we're going to have a 15-minute open Q&A from 8 to 8:15, or maybe more if we actually get done earlier. But we have index cards for you to write your questions down. We're happy to provide a microphone as well, but my experience shows from other forums that folks like to capture them on index cards with pens. So Melody over there, who's the president of Emerson PTA, one of our co-hosts of this, has those available for you, and I'll ask that she actually collect the cards throughout, so just hold them up when you have questions. And if not, I have questions to fill the time to best represent what you're thinking in the absence of those being provided. So hopefully you'll provide something. At this point, again, Bob, so the first question that we're going to ask our candidates are, we hear a lot about differentiated instruction, AIM, Title I schools and achievement gaps, English learners, students on IEPs, et cetera. How do teachers and the teaching ecosystem come together to optimize for each child, or is that an unrealistic expectation?
Thank you. I actually think there's a little bit of overlap between this question and number three when we talk about educational innovation, because I think some innovative ideas can contribute to effective differentiation. Back in 2013, as the district was trying to deal with the local control funding formula, come up with a local control accountability plan and a strategic plan, I served on the district's action team for professional development. And I think what really sort of shocked me at the time was how little professional development was offered in our district. I think there have been significant strides made since then. And I think that's a great thing, because I think effective differentiation requires a very rigorous professional development program. I think the challenge is to provide adequate oversight to make sure that differentiation is actually occurring in the classroom. And if you look at the educational literature, there's not agreement, universal agreement, that differentiation solves all problems. It does require a lot of work, a lot of attention, and I think the challenge is, when you have large class sizes, how do you effectively provide the differentiation? I think that's one of the key things that we have to ask ourselves. I think the other thing that I was sort of surprised at is the fact that professional development is not a required part of the teacher contract, and I think that with differentiation in our district. That was one of the main goals of the district, but yet only 63% of the teachers thus far have taken a professional development course in differentiation. So my concern is it consistent? Is it effective? We have to provide oversight, I think, to ensure that it's being done.
I don't think necessarily that it's about whether differentiation is right or wrong. I think differentiation is teaching. I mean, the concept of differentiated instruction is that we strive for a classroom in which a teacher is able to reach every student where they're at. And I think that was the gist of certainly the motion and the effort that took place about 18 months ago. It is true that, and I would agree, that how do you do that? That's the challenge. And the way we think you do it and do it best is through professional development. We believe that encouraging our teachers to take that professional development because they want to is the best course of action. And what that means is that the professional development be educator-driven. That is, that they are an equal partner with the district and us in terms of looking at what professional development opportunities exist. And it's our job as a district to make those offered, and we have. And indeed, they have taken, I think probably Susan knows the percentages off the top of her head, but it's substantial, but there's a lot more we can be doing and we will be doing. And certainly that accountability from the district that is actually happening in our classrooms is important and is part of our evaluation system. So I very much believe that it is not unrealistic expectation. I will always be a board member that pushes us to really get to the place where we all want to be, which is in every classroom, a teacher is reaching every child. But aside from professional development, there are other things that we should be looking at in addition to continually pushing to lower class sizes. So there are many things that we should be doing, and we are currently. I didn't know if that was enough.
Well, thank you. And so I'm just going to trade off those remarks because differentiation in instruction at its core is knowing where every child is and where they need to go and how to help them get there. So it's providing a variety of different learning strategies and giving kids opportunity to move at their own speed. And I think the best way to really describe this, so this is not theory. It's happening in many of our classrooms, more and more of our classrooms all the time. And both Common Core and technology are huge enablers of differentiation. But I want to just take a minute and describe, literally just a minute, and describe a classroom that I visited where it was a group, I believe it was sixth grade, working on math. And so it started with a number talk with everybody working together. How do you solve this problem? What different strategies might you have to do it? Where they were all discussing strategies that they would use and try and come up with some different ones. Then they broke into groups. Some of the groups were working with the teachers. Some were supported by interns. Some were self-directed. Some were doing project-based learning together with a fairly complicated exercise they were trying to work through. Some kids were on computers practicing number facts. And then kids who finished their activities ahead of time had iPads and were working on Khan Academy strategies at whatever level it is that they were interested in. That took place all within 15 minutes in a classroom. So it does take planning, but it doesn't have to be reinvented every day. It really can work very well for all kids, and it is working well for children in our district now. And then I guess if I got 30 seconds left, I would say it can expand beyond the classroom too. I think, classrooms are really a construct of adults to be able to educate a lot of kids. So we shouldn't be limited by the four walls of the classroom. If a child needs to move to a different grade level to get the right level of instruction, needs to move to a different school. We even have kids who go from the high school to UC Davis to be able to access higher level courses. So we have to break down some of the artificial walls that we've created within education and become more flexible around kids.
To share. Okay. The question here is, I like to concentrate on where it says, how do teachers and teaching ecosystem comes together to optimize each child? Is it an unrealistic expectation? Well, I am going to give you my experience as a teacher, because I can tell you that it only takes us just a few sessions in class to know where our students are. You as a teacher, you know them really well. And when you talk to them in front of a class, you develop an instinctive sense of who is paying attention, who is not. Just as was when I was talking to you, I instinctively look at you and so who is looking at me and who is writing or things like that. The point is that teachers are the best judges to be able to know where the kids are and who needs help and so on. But I believe that teachers realize the levels that they are and that they can classify the students in groups in such a way that those who can do and be challenged more, they could even move to a different level. What I believe in the, this is why I believe that in the AIM program, I would like to see something like a pre-AIM or so, where parents and teachers come together, make the decision, and then find out whether the child feels comfortable or they can succeed, and those who can succeed should stay and go on and achieve the best of their full potential. And I think that is the best way to optimize that relationship between teacher and child and help those who need help.
Thank you, candidates. We're now going to move to the second question. And again, if you're writing on index cards some of your questions, just hold up your hand and Melody will come pick them up. We're going to assume that you're asking it to all the candidates unless you specify otherwise. We'll continue to start with Bob through this round. By the way, when we go to the closing lightning round, we'll actually start with you, Alan.
Okay.
And then we have the guest questions, then we'll start with you. How can the school board, Superintendent Bose, and the local PTA, PTOs, and boosters work together, and to what end?
Well, it's been a privilege to be able to go around and sit in on a number of PTA, PTO meetings over the last several months. And I'm always amazed at the energy in the room and the creative ideas that they come up with. I am also impressed by the amounts of money that they raise to support various programs. I find it interesting that the elementary school PTAs are far ahead in fundraising than my daughter's home's junior high PTA. Be that as it may, I think sort of my response to this question is that I really think it is a matter of communication and strategizing. And I would advocate for a yearly workshop that would bring together the superintendent, the school board, PTA, PTO leadership, and even teachers to strategize and to plan what are the priorities either for an individual site or the school district as a whole. Several years ago, some of the PTAs, PTOs were actually raising money for counselors in the elementary school. And that has now changed with support for counselors from the school district. But that led to a severe inequity, in my view, that some schools had additional counselors and others did not. So I really think that it's important to communicate, to have a formal place where ideas can be shared. There's a tremendous number of great ideas out there that probably are restricted to one single school site just because that good idea has not been spread amongst other sites. So I think that would go a long way towards improving the cooperation, establishing best practices, deciding where monies might be effectively spent. And you know, I think that would be a great idea.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned the counseling issue, because actually when I was elected president, and one of my first priorities was really seeking alignment among our elementary schools as it relates to counseling, because that was one example of where there is some inequities throughout our district when certain PTAs can raise a level of funding and then use that funding for permanent employees that are ultimately the district's responsibilities. And so I made it a priority to really clearly communicate that, you know, when it comes to hiring certificated staff, that is teachers and counselors and others, the board, really need to set the standards of what we want among all of our elementary schools and then provide those, as opposed to leaving it to the devices of a particular PTA to fundraise to then hire those positions. So that was an issue I took up, and I'm proud that I did, because really what that was about was equity. But I will say that we have a tremendous PTA, PTO community in our district. For the specific things that the school board and the superintendent can do, I think we've done a lot of it in that we've established board office hours. We, in the year I was president, we assigned each trustee with responsibilities at each school for the purposes of them checking into the PTA, PTOs at those individual campuses to ensure that we were touching all parts of our district at all times. So I think that it's certainly something that, as you mentioned, communication about expectations is really important. And I think that we have done a good deal amount of work in this area. And I'm proud to say that I believe that we have a great current relationship and work well with our PTA and PTOs.
Okay, so the question was, how can I work together and to what end? So the end is student success. I think that is where we align all of our efforts in the district. And while PTAs and PTOs do a wonderful job fundraising, and that is greatly appreciated, I know, having served on a number of them, that that's not the highest purpose of the organizations. I think the most important role that PTAs and PTOs can play is to be a conduit for information between the district, between the school board, and to really get the that information flowing two ways. So the superintendent's parent advisory committee is an important place where parent leadership comes on a monthly basis to communicate with the superintendent and then share information back to their groups. There's two things that I would want to mention as very specific opportunities. One of them is this Thursday, which I'm sure I'm going to see many of you at this event. This is the second year that the district is hosting a school governance workshop. That's an opportunity for administrators and parents, the leadership of the site councils and the PTAs and PTOs, to come together with district administration and really work in a workshop environment around the table and identify what are the priorities and the strategies for the district, and then to learn more about, you know, the budget, if you want to know more about the budget. So that is happening this Thursday. It's an annual event. There's a very nice dinner that's served along with it. So we do try to make it a pleasant event. The second is the LCAP advisory, the Local Control and Accountability Plan advisory, something that's existed for 3 years. Parent participation starts high there and kind of falls off by the end of the year at the most critical time when we're allocating resources to our high-need students. So I'd really encourage more parent participation there, because it will help inform budget priorities.
I think I like to concentrate on the question how they can work together and to what end. One of the proposals that I have made, and I would like to make it again, is that to mitigate the need for parcel taxes or to boost the funding of schools, that each school would have like the ability to apply for grants, and that the district would have a coordinator, a full-time position, to be able to help the individual schools to also raise money. That there's no, as I see now, PTAs raise money, but there's not much communication with the district in that sense. But I would like to see a two-way street so that the funding would be boosted for the entire district. I think even if they get the smaller grants for a specific purpose at schools, they will raise far more money than the parcel taxes. I am very happy that my colleague Bob brought it up at another meeting, because I think it's a great idea to be able to go high and go for where you can make a difference, and actually could be for specific purposes, so that the budget of each school would increase and there would be a two-way communication with the district for that purpose. Yes, I think the communication is very important, and I think a relationship and coordinating with the superintendent would create an environment of cooperation, and I believe that is a good way to have a good relationship between the superintendent and the PTAs.
Fantastic, thank you. So let's go through the third question, and again, hopefully you're writing down some questions on index cards that Melody can come and gather. This is our final question that we've identified. We talk a lot about using technology as part of our long-range plan. What other innovations in education should we consider? And again, we're starting off with Bob.
Oh, okay. Well, I think this is a very interesting question. When we answered the Vanguard's third question, somebody posted in response to our responses a link to a YouTube video. And I would encourage you to follow that link, because it really is an indictment against some of the traditional ways we've tried to teach. So I think technology is going to play a very important role, and there are a number of other innovations that can be applied. I think we just have to reimagine teaching. I think we have to get away from the lecturing that is so common. We should rely more on inquiry-based, hands-on learning experiences. Technology can fill a role, but the bottom line is the foundation of education is good teachers. And the teachers have to know how to effectively use technology. At the Venerey School, we have some very highly equipped classrooms, and we actually have audience response clickers, so that the kids out there in a lecture, you ask them a question and they can respond, and you can get some instant feedback. Now, I really haven't seen that at a high school level yet, but I think that would be an interesting technology, and it's relatively cheap to engage students a little bit more effectively. I think we can't be constrained by age or grades as much as we have been. I think we have to rely more on mastery of skills rather than age grouping, and I think we have to focus on critical thinking skills. One area that I think we could do a much better job is involving private-public partnerships. I think we're in a very high-tech area, and I think that if we could find a way to effectively partner with private industries, and that's why I was a big supporter of the innovation parks, because I think that would bring in some high-tech industries, that would be a great way to stay current with technology and bring some technology into the classroom. There are some politically difficult approaches, and year-round schooling would be one.
Good thing there are no students.
Well, I think that when we think about innovation, a lot of times we think about sort of computers in a classroom, but really I look at this question and I think about not only ways we can innovate in the classroom, but ways we can innovate as a district. You know, we are a local government, a governing body, and what are some of those things that we can do? I was one of the members of the strategic planning committee that convened 3 years ago, and I think the work that came out of that process is really one of the more innovative things we are starting to do as a district, and that is we set in there as a goal to allow or require our students to set a goal at the beginning of the year and then track that goal, make it the responsibility of the district and the teachers to learn what each child's goal is. That's something that, and we are working now to systematize that. What that means is that really that is us taking an affirmative step to really ignite a love of learning in each child, because we are taking an affirmative interest in what each individual child wants out of their educational experience. And so I think that that's certainly one area of innovation that we're currently pursuing, and I'm proud of the work, and that if and when implemented, we will have a system wherein our kids matriculate through our schools, and each year our teacher is informed about what they want to learn about, whether it's aviation or some, you know, sports. They can integrate that into the curriculum and learning. But there are other ways to innovate, and I'm, you know, we're looking at those, whether it's developing an internship program to encourage the type of professionals development and to deal with the teacher shortage that we're all going to have to live with, or it's really offering avenues through which our teachers can really attain professional development. I think that innovation is something that's more than just coding and technology in that way.
So I think any visioning process kind of starts with where you are, you decide where you want to go, and you figure out how you're going to get there. And that was really our strategic planning process, so I'm really pleased to hear it coming up over and over again. And I think the vision of differentiated instruction is a real lodestar in that conversation. How do we meet each child where they are, provide them a challenging environment, help them get vested in their own education? So there's no shortage of good ideas. There's no shortage of great teaching in this district. There is a shortage of good facilities to really support those programs, particularly science labs. So I don't know how many of you have kids here and have seen the science labs here, but they could use some significant improvements. So could the arts and the shops that are in this location. High school has some spaces that if you walked into those classrooms, you would not believe that they were in Davis, in our community. And all of our campuses have opportunities for improvement around facilities. But if we really want to focus on STEM education, career technical education, we have to invest in the facilities to be able to have the right tools for teachers to be able to teach really exciting, innovative programs that really attract kids. So science labs, our career technical education facilities, like robotics, like our agriculture program at the high school. We've talked for many years about a culinary arts program, which requires good facilities much better than we have. Garden facilities, also a good way to get that started at elementary school. And then internships. I think Alan mentioned this. I really think there's an opportunity for growth. DaVinci has a wonderful internship program. They have an intern coordinator who helps develop those relationships for kids all year long. I think we need something like that at Davis High. We had a discussion around that as part of a parcel tax, but it would have required increasing the size of the parcel tax. So these are still opportunities I think we're looking to fund.
I'm going to give you a little more direct and different answer coming again from the teacher's perspective, because I have been involved in using technology for a while and doing research in this area. This is why I would like to implement some of these ideas in the district here. You know how your kids have nowadays cell phones, iPads, and sometimes we think that they spend too much time on them and not do their homework or so? Well, you can use these tools to learn. If the teacher is given the tools to put notes and tips for classes in YouTube, nowadays kids watch those. They can prepare for exams like that. They can have communication with their teachers with their devices. So I have decided that to try some of these techniques on my own courses, and I do not prohibit the iPads or cell phones in my class. I do quite the opposite, so that they can use it and learn these tools for learning purposes. The idea, for example, of a flipped classroom where students prepare, they first prepare the lecture ahead of time and they hear and do exercises in class, that's another idea. There would be a time where the teacher would be relieved of doing so much grading that is hard on them, but make it more automatic and give feedback to students faster. And why not use the tools that we have, and there are software out there, hardware. There's also communications, Facebook, WhatsApp, that use the right way could be great tools for implementing new technologies. Bob mentioned the clickers. That's wonderful to get feedback immediately. And I think there's other tools like that.
Thank you. Now what we're going to do is transition. We have two parts left in a forum. Thank you, Melody, for collecting the cards and bringing those up. The first will be essentially a 30-second closing lightning round, which will be starting with Alan and working this way. And then, like I said, when we get to audience questions, we'll start with Susan and then rotate that way. So at this point, we'll start with Alan. You have 30 seconds. Again, a reminder to go directly to red.
Because I believed we needed a diversity of perspective and experience on the board. I think I offer that. I'm the only one on the board currently that attended UC Davis and has that student perspective. My practice is public law, which is local government, which is what a school district is. So I have great familiarity, and I'm the only one on the board with that and the only one in this race. I also think it's worth noting that I've, with the exception of Professor Granda, lived in the community the longest and volunteered, and so I know all about the community in many ways. So,
that's it. That's fast.
That is yeah, really. Okay, we'll speed that one. This is making up for the 5 minutes that we used at the beginning. So I'm honored to have served on the Davis School Board since 2007, leading really some positive changes amid some challenging times. And I am personally deeply motivated to contribute the knowledge, the relationships, and the experience that I've gained in my service on the board so that Davis schools continue to excel, and most importantly, so that every child succeeds. So a couple of priorities we didn't touch on. I'm interested, as Alan had said, recruiting and retaining high-quality educators, lowering the cost of health benefits to increase access for everyone, improving school climate and working conditions, and investing in facilities.
I think I would say elect the two teachers candidates. That would be my pitch to you, because we have the best interest on your kids. We have the tools, and we know how to help teachers achieve those goals from the experience that we had. I think that if you like to have a change on the board, a little bit more diversity of opinion, I think you should vote for me.
Okay, I think it's Dr. Bob here.
I probably don't need it, but I got two now. So I think it's important for the voters to consider what attributes they would like to see in a school board trustee. I think I can bring some very positive attributes to the board. I'm willing to listen and to observe. I think that is one of the most critical attributes that a school board member could have. I have a willingness to learn. I don't have all the answers, but in our very educated community, I think we have some very creative solutions that we have to tap into. I'm willing to collaborate and find common ground and compromise. I think that's important.
Well, congratulations, everybody. 30 seconds. The reason that I constructed it that way was so that everybody could kind of wrap with really netting it out for their message and their brand and what's important for their candidacy. Okay, at this point, what we're going to do is move to, we have a few audience questions. What we'll do is, again, we'll start with Susan, so I'll hand this back in a moment. And then I don't think any of them have specified one candidate. If they have, I'll be sure to call that out. So the first question is, and everybody, 1 minute response. Just monitor at 30. You have plenty of time here. Is there anything that you would change about the district's sex education curriculum? If so, what?
Wow, that's a specific question. So I do think that the health program, which is where much of the sex education as well as science at the elementary school, has gone through sort of regular revisions periodically to make sure that it's up to date and relevant for students. Just one very specific thing that did come to my attention recently that I've been working on related to the health curriculum was shaken baby syndrome. So if you are actually able to access students at their high school level, thank you, for with the kind of information about how easy it is to hurt a baby, then that is the age group, often very young parents, where that occurs. And we have a recent case of that in our community. So sharing that information through our health curriculum is something that I've been working on with the Rotary Club.
Me?
If you'd like me to repeat the question, I can too, but it's is there anything that you would change about the district's sex education curriculum? If so, what?
What the, I didn't get that. You mean sex education or what?
Sex education.
Okay, because I heard just about, in general, the curriculum in the district.
What I'm going to do with these, a single question, I'll pass them down actually for you. If they have multiple, I'll just keep it.
Well, I think from my perspective, I would like to see that there is not a politically correct way of doing this, but rather a respectful way where everybody's opinions are heard. And mainly, I think you need feedback from the parents. And this is a subject in which there's not much communication with the school, and that has been the case since my kids were in the school, so that's what I would change.
Yeah, I hello.
Here, Dr.
You know, I think Jose brings up a very good point. I do think we have to be sensitive to, you know, parental concerns about a lot of the topics that may come up. I can tell you from my standpoint and hearing from my two girls, I think we have an excellent curriculum here. I do have to say I would have to learn more about the specifics to really make a sound judgment as to any potential changes. I think it has to be a supportive environment. I think it has to be an open and honest discussion. And I truly believe that is the best way to present information to our children so they're in the best position to be able to deal with a lot of questions that they're going to have to deal with.
So the question about is there anything I would change, and the answer is I suppose so, and it's just more of it, more education. Susan mentioned around our health curriculum and certainly biology, and that's important. But I think that this is a topic that spans subject. It's one that we actually have been looking at as a board, not only sex education, but gender equity. And so I think it's important that we ensure that the literature that our children are reading have balance among female authorship and male authorship. And I think, you know, we have to just continually be open and looking at all parts of our curriculum, not only health, but literature, history, sociology. And so I guess I would constantly be looking at ways to improve our education in this way and seek out other multidisciplinary avenues through which to pursue it.
Thank you. Our next question, and I'll be able to hand this out also. If technology is part of your long-range plan, how do you plan to fund it and provide equity between schools, training for teachers, and support staff to maintain it? So don't start the timer just yet. I'm going to actually give you the card because there's a lot there. And so, yep, let's go ahead and start, and then we'll move it around that way. After this question, we're going to move back to you, Dr. Granda, to start.
Okay.
So we have been quite blessed in terms of technology funding over the past 2 years. So the state of California has had a particularly good couple of years. We're not anticipating that's going to continue, but has designated some one-time funding for technology. So there's been significant investment in technology over the past 2 years. I understand that the question is the long-range plan. So we have been able to actually implement where we have one device. We use Chromebooks to three students at this point, carts that move around between the classrooms. Those are much less expensive than the old computer labs that we used to fund, so it's easier to be able to turn over a portion of those on a regular basis. That's going to have to become part of our regular budget. That isn't something that we can depend on PTAs or parent communities to fund for us all the time. All of our professional development now, I think, really does incorporate technology strategies. Not, you know, everything needs it, but I think it's important that it be a component of all professional learning. And the technology support at the individual school sites, I think varies still. I don't think we have a good standard of maintaining that yet, so more work to do there.
Is it going down?
Okay.
I think this question touches on one of the T's, you know, the technology. And I would say that because the question is how to fund it, I hope the district, with any money that has extra, because I consider the parcel taxes being extra money, not part of the budget, that they would direct those towards this end. And also the application for grants specifically for technology. There is a lot of grants from the board of from the Department of Education for this, and I think we just need to tap those resources, and particularly somebody like the Bill Gates Foundation, who gave money to the district here for a specific purpose. That would be like that, and others are what I would suggest that we tap into, fund and train teachers to use technology in the classroom in the long range plan.
Well, I love this question. I don't know whether is that on?
Here.
Okay.
It's so weird.
Anyway. Well, I love this question because it really fits into one of my main areas of focus. This is still not on, but you can hear me, right? I really think that this fits in very nicely with partnering with our resources, our partners in the community. I'm a strong believer that UC Davis should be more actively involved in our schools. I became aware that an elementary school was interested in getting microscopes. The Bargain Barn, for heaven's sakes, has tons of microscopes just sitting there. UC Davis helps support the robotics program. I think that's where the public-private partnerships could really come into play. Technology changes so fast, I don't know that schools with the funding level we have can keep up. So we just have to be creative in terms of staying state of the art. And that also spills over into our current technical education, because that requires a lot of resources. And those are programs designed to prepare kids who are not going to go to a four-year college, who are going to graduate from high school and probably earn more money than I am earning now as a university professor.
Can I see that? Thanks. Technology is really an important part of designing the classrooms of today and tomorrow. And certainly, as I mentioned at the outset, really enhancing our school facilities is a priority of mine. I think there needs to be a major investment district-wide among our facilities. There still are campuses that teachers don't have any Wi-Fi access. So I would really look to, and the question asks, how do you plan to fund it? I would really look first and foremost to the facility funding that may be available to us should the state pass its statewide facility bond, which I support. But also that at the appropriate time, we looking at really our long plan, a long-term plan for facility funding, because I think a renewed investment in that way is needed. And I think that it's important that we make sure that whatever technology we have, it has to be supported by the district. And that's been a continuing problem, that we might have this technology, but it's not supported.
Thank you. We have, great news is we've been submitted a number of questions, almost 8 in total across 2 cards. We have time for 2 of them to keep on track of time. So I'm gonna pick one from each card. And then I believe after that, I'll wrap it up with my closing comments. And then there will be collateral here from the candidates, as well as the candidates themselves will be here for a few minutes after the program, which will end at 8:15. So the first question, can you please give us an example of a differentiation lesson in a primary grade that's not a math lesson? Hopefully one you've seen. We're actually gonna start with Dr. Granda.
That's a very interesting question for me. You put me on the spot because I that's what I teach, you know? So what I can tell you, for example, on a differentiation is I will relate to the experiences in Germany when my son and my daughter were there. There was a big emphasis on art, just to discover how whether the students had the ability to do abstract conceptions, whether they were painting sculptures or you name it. There was the promotion of how students can appreciate opera or things like that we really don't do here. But I think we need to be innovative to give opportunity to these new things. And I just always concentrate that the teacher is the best judge for this.
Well, that's another very specific question, and I have not had the opportunity to observe much of the differentiation that goes on in our schools. So, you know, I think it is something that, again, requires some very intense professional development to make sure it's done correctly, and I think that's a role where technology can play an important part in differentiation. But again, I think that's a little too specific that I can't give you an exact example.
Well, I think the question was about elementary non-math differentiation. Answer, book in the bag. I guess leave it to the one candidate up here with elementary school kids, which means that I'll be in this district a long time after this term and have to live with the decisions we make. But what the Book in the Bag program is it's a program that is largely volunteer run by parents and grandparents, actually, within our schools, where we endeavor to have every child leave the school day with a book. And why is it differentiation? Because it's that parent community that relies on that book being read to then assess whether or not they're ready for another book at another level. So Book in the Bag is a program that happens in our district, and it's a great example of differentiation at elementary that's non-math.
Good. Well, I think that the principles of the example that I gave that was a fifth or sixth grade classroom in math are the same for primary and non-math lessons. I mean, you want to use a variety of techniques, individual instruction, small group instruction, whole group instruction. Using the elements of project-based learning is something that you can do with any age group. Technology can enhance instruction for any age kids. We do pull in and pull out instruction already in all of our classrooms. We level reading groups across all grades. And then that ability to move across classrooms to a higher grade level or to, again, a different school. So I think the elements are the same. The elements of differentiation are the same, regardless of the age group or the topic. Subject.
Thank you. This is our final question. And I think let's do this one with whomever feels compelled to answer it first. It's not a survival of the fittest with 3 mics, I promise. All right, this is an interesting question. How do you ensure parent involvement in decision-making? It seems like speaking at board meetings doesn't really seem to work. Many parents can't be on LCAP or strategic committees to provide input.
Should I go? Since I have the microphone in front of me, I mean, this is obviously something that I've thought a lot about because I've been involved in parent groups for many, many years in Davis. It is the hardest thing to accomplish. I mean, I think PTAs and PTOs are really helpful as our site councils in getting that parental involvement at the school level that then can feed up through the leadership into the district office. But one of the reasons that we did the district dollars program was because there were a lot of questions around the budget, how the money was spent, and we wanted to be able to get people to share what they valued when we were actually having to make budget reductions. So that was created to be something you could access in your own time, spend as long as you wanted. You've got some simple screens that give you an overview, lots of links that you can go deeper. So something that you could access in your own time and provide input to the district whenever you had that opportunity available to you.
Just a couple of comments. Yeah, I think one of the most important things to engage parents is active listening, because, you know, going out and walking the neighborhoods, I'm always amazed at how engaged parents can become if you just listen to some of their concerns and some of their ideas. So I think that's an incredible asset to have. I think that one thing that would be a priority is, if I was on the school board, is I have tried to navigate our website, and there is a tremendous amount of information there, but it is not very accessible. I think we could be doing a lot better job with that. And that might be an opportunity to partner with people at UC Davis in terms of students becoming involved in a project, helping move that along. I think School Loop has been a great way to reach out to parents. I use it all the time, and it's a great way to monitor your kids' progress. I think the real key is, how do you engage those parents that are not inclined to be engaged at all? And that's particularly true with at-risk kids.
I'll go. Sure. Well, I think we actually, as a board, do a good job on getting parents engaged in our decision-making process. But does not mean that we can't do better. I think that we as a board have continually looked for ways to expand our reach. I've mentioned, certainly the board office hours being one. Secondly, I've mentioned the, you know, assigning trustees with responsibility. But I think we still need to do more, particularly as Bob mentioned, really with, we owe a responsibility to our student community to reach those parent voices we're not hearing from. And so I think it means, you know, weekend events and nighttime events and daytime events, just offering more flexibility within our district for that parental input. And I would certainly, and have encouraged us to expand our reach as best possible.
I think I agree with the person who asked the question that it's difficult, that communication between parents and the board. And in fact, board meetings, the situation is tense many times in the past. It has gotten better with this board, but in the past, the board didn't want to listen to the person speaking and treated them not in a very nice way. I think that if you elect me, what I would do is I would hold office hours at specific times and visit schools. And you saw from my pictures in there, one of those was a project with parents, where we actually built airplanes, parents and kids together. So if you have somebody from the board visiting a school and doing a little project that invites the parents and the kids at the same time, would break the ice, and I would be very happy to do something like that.
We made it. Congratulations, everybody. So a few wrapping remarks on my part. First of all, thanks to Melody, Patwin, or excuse me, the PTA president for Emerson. And on behalf of Patwin and our school, PTA, thank you. And also Grace for our DaVinci boosters, thank you very much. We're sponsored tonight by Davis Media Access, who's been kind enough to record this and will make this available on our website. So we'll make sure to contact through the PTAs, excuse me, to notify that it's available. Thanks also to those of you who asked questions. Thank you to the Davis Enterprise for coming this evening as well to cover this discussion. And most of all, I'd really like to thank the four candidates for investing your time with us this evening. Susan Lovenburg, Alan Fernandes, Bob Poppenga, and Dr. Jose Granda. So thank you very much, and this concludes our forum.